Hello, Steve from Unexplored Films here, back with another filmmaking DIY effect tutorial. And today we are trying a missing face effect. Now, this is possibly a bit more of a gory effect to try this time, but it was one that we were really keen to have a go at. This is designed to make it look like half the face is missing and showing through to the skull underneath, and it's been used in the TV show Breaking Bad for Gus Fring, and in The Dark Knight with Harvey Two Face, and it's also a little similar to Imhotep in The Mummy and the cursed pirates in the first Pirates of the Caribbean film. So this could be a fun one to do if you're trying something with a fantasy element. Now, once again, I've picked quite an ambitious effect to recreate this time. This is not an incredibly easy thing to do, but I'm always trying to do a lot with a little, just using the tools and equipment I already have. And if you're enjoying these DIY Hollywood effect tutorials, please subscribe and you will get to see some more. And a big thank you for all the amazing support so far for this channel. So we basically used the shot from Breaking Bad, massive spoiler alert, as our template. And part of the reason this works so well is they use a camera move to reveal the missing face. So we set up a slider pointing at a doorway, and the idea would be the character would appear in the doorway and the camera would slowly reposition to reveal the face head on. So we did a few tests for the blocking and worked out where I would need to stand. Now, one of the reasons this is quite a difficult effect is that the skull requires 3D animation to match the head movement, and this was the first time I had tried anything like this. But I decided to film the raw elements first and then worry about that later. And if you want to see why it's good to film something that's going to be very complicated to composite as steadily as possible and then add the movement later, check out my video on how to do a clone effect using a regular slider with no motion control. So we tried this effect without knowing if this method would work, but we made a start by covering half my face in green face paint for the area that would be missing, and disguising the join with some makeup to look like burn marks. We also prepared a prop shirt where half of it was ripped and damaged, and finally we added some dots to the green part of my face using red gaffer tape, and my plan was to use these as tracking markers in case I needed to cleanly track the movement of the face. But all of this was an experiment, and we didn't know exactly how we would edit this until we'd filmed it. So next we worked out the blocking with the slider, and I had a monitor off to one side where I could see what we were getting. Now, although the shot in Breaking Bad reveals the skeleton face as the camera is still moving, we cheated a little bit and decided to make the camera move stop before I would turn and reveal the face. This was because I didn't know if this effect was going to work very well, and I wanted to limit all of the problems that we might face. We also deliberately kept the light off in the shed behind the door, because again, I thought this would make it easier to disguise any problems with the compositing if the area behind was completely black. So we tried the camera move and the blocking a few times until we thought we had a pretty good take. The character walks out of the door looking dazed, the camera stops, and then the character turns to look facing the lens, revealing the face, before finally dropping out of frame as if he dies, or at least needs some emergency care. Once we had the winning take, I was pretty confident that I could use this in order to do the compositing. I also knew I wanted to create an explosion, so for reference, I flicked the lights on and off with the camera in its first position. And that was everything we needed to film, and then it was time to head into the edit bay. So as usual, the first step was to load up the winning take into Premiere Pro, which is where I do all my finishing and sound design, and then replace it with an After Effects composition to send the same clip into After Effects. And like a lot of these effects, you can do some of this in Premiere as well, but I prefer After Effects because I think it gives me more control. So the first thing to do in After Effects was to duplicate the clip so that we had a second layer, and to use the key light effect on the top layer to remove the green areas of the face. And using the screen matte option, you can easily see the area that's getting affected and then refine it. With the layer underneath turned off, this showed a transparent area now where the green face used to be. And by drawing a mask around the figure using the pen tool, we now had this as a separate layer on top of the original clip, which could serve as a background. Next, I added a black solid and masked that out into a simple shape using the pen tool, which just allowed me to see the face without the green area. And now you can see why I shot this in front of a dark doorway, so that I wouldn't have to worry about the edges of the black solid. So now it was time to tackle the 3D skull. Now, as I say, I am not a 3D animator and I had never tried this before, but I had recently learned about a free program called Blender, which is a powerful 3D animation program. And the best thing is there is a website called BlendSwap where people share their 3D models, which meant I didn't need to build this from scratch. So I downloaded Blender and I downloaded the skull. Now, as I say, I hadn't used Blender at all, so I was completely new to it and it was a little bit intimidating at first, but just by watching a couple of tutorials, I found that I could learn the bare minimum to do this effect. This meant that I could use the original footage as a background and then animate the skull over the top. So to make things easier, I created a new composition with the original clip in After Effects and used the Stabilize Motion tool using two motion trackers on the tracking markers on the face. By ticking position, rotation, and scale, this provided a pretty neat stabilized version of the clip of me performing the move. The tracking markers didn't quite work at the beginning and the end, where the software kind of got confused, so I manually added those keyframes to the beginning and the end. Next, I added a rule of thirds grid just to see if the head was going to stay in the middle, which it pretty much did, and then exported this stabilized version of the footage as a separate clip. And this is a little bit like the Beats headphones commercials, where the headphone always stays in the middle of the screen. Next, I could add this clip in Blender as my layer behind the 3D skull. Now, rather than trying to do a crash course in Blender, I will simply provide the links for the tutorials that I watched in order to learn how to animate this. So now I was able to line up the skull on top of the stabilized part of the original footage. And I'm sure there might be easier ways to do it than this if I knew a lot about 3D animation, but I manually tried to keyframe the skull to match the movements of the head, using position, rotation, and scale. I had no idea if this would work, but I gave it my best shot. The export of the stabilized head was very handy here because it kind of limited the movements that the skull had to do, because the head is pretty stationary for the whole middle part. The main thing was to get a turn of the head right at the beginning, and then another turn of the head the other direction and a kind of tilt up at the end. Now this required a lot of trial and error, so I did not get this right the first time. Next, I exported the animated skull from Blender, which created a series of PNG images on a transparent background. And for those of you who don't want to learn Blender and who just want to use 2D elements, the 3D images on sites such as Sketchfab allow you to rotate the image and see all the way around it. There's nothing to stop you doing a screen recording of a 3D skull that you can find online. If you filmed a very simple, much more basic move than what I did, you could probably use that screen recording as your skull to composite in. Next, I realized I would have to attach this to the face and get it to move in exactly the same way. So once again, I used the same tracking markers on the face, and this time clicked Track Motion. This provided the exact same move that I had done on the stabilized clip I used for reference. Next, I created a new null object, which is just an invisible thing which you can attach other things to so that they don't move around. Then I applied the motion from the motion track to the null object. This meant that the null object, this red square, would then move in exactly the same way as the tracking markers on the face. And again, it couldn't really get it right at the start and the end, so I manually keyframed that. So then I could bring in the Blender export files, which were just an image sequence, and I made sure to conform that to the same frame rate as the project. I could then drop this in on top and parent that layer to the null object. Once I lined up the skull on top of the face, the middle part of the clip stayed pretty much where it was meant to. So to get a better idea of whether this would work, I took the skull layer and simply dropped it underneath the layer with the missing face. Now I could really see if the skull was lining up or not, and of course it definitely wasn't on the head turn at the beginning. So again, I could use the tracking markers for reference to try and manually line up the skull over the face as the head turn happened. And this took a lot of trial and error, and I did this a fair few times before I got one that I thought worked. This is because our brains are really good at spotting when something doesn't look right, and trying to line up a 3D object on top of another 3D object was really, really hard. And if you want to see more about trying to perfectly line up one layer on top of another, check out my Mission Impossible Mask Effect tutorial. Eventually though, I got the skull moving in a fairly decent way, and the next thing to do was to remove the tracking markers and the eye, which of course I hadn't covered up, using a separate mask, which I then keyframed to match the movement. When I did the animation in Blender, I was never going to get the moves 100% right. And I actually went back and changed the animation a few times during this process and just kept re-exporting the skull until it was looking better. I also worked out how to change the lighting that had been provided with the 3D model in Blender so that I could better match the light that we used when we filmed the original take. And although I was never happy 100% with the move, I got it to a point where I thought it matched the face as well as I could. I added another black solid and created a mask just down the edge of the face. This was to try and disguise the join between the skull and the head a bit more and make it look a bit more like the burn marks that we had added with the makeup. I parented the shadow layer to the same null object so that it would move with everything else. Next, I wanted to add some bloodier texture, so I took a look at Unsplash, which is a great site that provides free stock images for you to use. I searched for meat and found a close-up of some meat, and actually used this as the area down the face to give me some slightly bloodied looking skin texture. I did this because I remembered they had done something similar in Pirates of the Caribbean by scanning strips of turkey jerky into the computer to create some of the pirates' ragged faces. And once again, I paired this meat layer to the null object so that it would move with everything else. So now we had the face looking pretty good, and it was time for some finishing touches. For the explosion, I used Video Copilot's excellent Action Essentials, which I've had for a long time. I masked out the shed wall on the right side of the screen, which meant that I could drop in the explosions behind it. I also added some dust elements from Action Essentials to cover the whole image. Next, I added some falling debris from the ceiling inside the shed. Next, I went back and found the clip of me switching the light on in the shed. I took this and lined up the light coming on at the very moment when the explosion happens, and I increased the temperature on that to make it look even hotter. Finally, I duplicated this clip and masked out the windows in the glass door on the top layer. This meant I could duplicate the fire slotted in between the two layers and kind of make it look like a little reflection when the explosion happens. This is all just building credibility that this is all stuff that's actually happening and hasn't been added afterwards. Finally, I pre-composed everything into a single composition, which is usually a good way to finish, because then you can add any final effects to the whole sequence in one go. I added an adjustment layer to the whole thing, and then did a little bit of color correction just to make it look a little bit more dramatic. And finally, I added some artificial camera movement, and our friends over at cinecom.net have provided a great free set of fake handheld movements to be applied to your footage. So finally, I went back into Premiere, where I could see the finished After Effects composition, and did my sound design. So I started with the location sound of the footsteps, and added the explosion and lots of noises to match the debris falling. And I used the same trick as in the superhero landing effect video by adding a burglar alarm in the background to make it sound like this was a really loud thing which had caused a lot of damage nearby. I also added some ear ringing and a couple of other things just to make it sound like this was from the character's point of view. And yeah, it is not his day. So there you have it, that's how we took our basic slider shot of the shed doorway with the figure appearing and added everything else to make it look like the face was missing and something had gone very badly wrong. And if you enjoyed this one, why not drop a comment for what Hollywood effect you would like to see recreated next. So guys, I really hope you enjoyed that. Please hit that subscribe button and you will see some more of these. I have been Steve from Unexplored Films, and I will see you next time.